tonight's subject is eschatology. The term eschatology has been used only since the 1970s, something that we are all really taught. But in the religious world, they've taken the word and thrown it all over the place, each claiming that they know when the end is coming. Or the word being means the doctrine of the end, the end of history. But it has nothing to do with secular history. And salvation history has already been brought to its climax and fulfillment. So it's got nothing to do with this world and the stars falling and all these things that people talk about. So when all these religious leaders get up in the meeting and say the signs are on us for the end of the world, that's not a nonsense. It has nothing to do with anything about moons and stars and whatnot. It's all about salvation history. And God has already brought that to climax and fulfillment in the story of Jesus Christ. It is in the individual that the great dramatic events in the life of Jesus happen. The story of Jesus is an active parable. Which I can tell you, and you can tell me, is that what you're going to believe. For the story is to take place in the individual. Everything said of him actually happens in the individual. And when it happens, that is the abrupt cleavage between this world and you can call it the supernatural world of God. The thing is this, and this is coming when they occur in the world, they rest, they wait, they act. They are restored to life, and they rest, they wait, they act. And seemingly for ever, until this salvation history takes place in them. And then they are cast in the central world. They are the star of the drama. And they will experience the story of Jesus Christ in a first person singular, present tense experience. And then they will know who Jesus Christ really is. So he's not coming from the devil. He is within, dreaming the dream of life. And he will be within man as that man. This is the Christ of whom I speak. And I'm speaking from experience. I am not theorizing. I'm not speculating. He does not know you mean. And no one could have been more successful than the speaker when he walked in me and completed himself in the same number of days as the scripture that it would take. 1,260 days for the four million events to take place. Other events take place too. But they are not of the nature, yet they are all related to scripture. Everything is perfect in scripture. And he says to the example, I come to fulfill scripture. All scripture. Doesn't it just concerning God's plan of salvation? And if you want to read the scripture of eschatology in the Bible, you are reading the 13th chapter of the book of Mark and the 24th chapter of the book of Matthew. In these chapters, it is said, they look at the villains, these lovely villains, and one calls his attention to the fact that these buildings were beautiful. And he said, you see these buildings? He said, not be like one stone standing upon another, but one shall be cast down. And then they said, in plain, will this be? Friends, look at this. And he said, that there will be false prophets, false teachers, who will come into the world and say, I am Christ. Do not believe him. Or they will come and help us. In the hope that he will mislead and lead us away, if possible, even to be there. But take heed, I have told you all things beforehand. What he tells you is his vital. It's an active prayer, as I put it to life, to a prayer. At the end of the day, I will interpret the faithful. And I will tell you that you saw legislation that what you have just seen is a plan that will unfold in you, and you will be like that in the story of the world. Whether you believe or not, that is entirely up to you. I will show you the plan. And having seen the plan, then I will try to tell you. What it means, and this is God's plan of redemption, God's plan of salvation. And everyone will be redeemed, because it is only God redeeming himself. It is God who came into the world of death. And it is God who departs from this world of death. His purpose has been fulfilled. And the purpose of the descent into the world of death is to expand himself. His wisdom must expand. He is not omniscient. There will be no way to leave if you are anything left. His power will be expanded because he is not omnipotent. Therefore, everything is an expansion. And to reach that expansion, he first must contract and limit himself to the state called death. And this is the mystery of life through death. The seed falls into the earth and dies. It falls to be made alive. It is done fairly reasonable. But it is done, it brings forth much. And the result is the expansion of God to we on the dogs who form the world. So for the child, all the body is a son of God, the power of God, the wisdom of God. But when people forget to accept that, because it has to put on these garments of death. And then he will know when he's about to depart from this world by reason of these signs. And when the signs begin to unfold in them, and the expectations of the signs, they are the central figure. They are the star in the entire place. And all of these signs, then, they remember who Jesus Christ is. So we are now in the 13th chapter of Mark. If anyone says to you, look, here is Christ. Although there he is, do not believe it. Because I'm talking to another Jesus. If I say, look, there he is, I'm showing you another. There is no other Christ than the Christ in you. God has to between man that man may become one. So if there is any Christ other than that universal Christ, that when the crucified and died within man, that Christ is a false Christ. And Paul teaches, talk about it. And tell you of a Christ who is going to come from the earth. And tell you of another Christ who came 2,000 years ago. The story is an active battle. So when Paul has he not been here, these are his words to the Galatians. And scholars have all agreed that the New Testament of the Galatians is the first New Testament book. Written approximately 50 years AD. They consider that letter the oldest of the New Testament works. And in this he turns to the Galatians. He says, O foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? Before whose eyes Jesus Christ was publicly portrayed as crucified. Let me ask you only this. Did you receive the Spirit by the words of the Lord, or by the Spirit with faith? Are you so foolish, having received the Spirit, are you not angry with the flesh? Well, the whole vast Christian world, and those who hear of the Christian mystery, have angry with the flesh. For they think in terms of a fleshly being called Jesus Christ. And this is not a fleshly being at all. Why do I walk this earth as a being of blood and flesh? In me, in an entirely different way, the plan of salvation erupts, which abruptly cleaves this space, this time section, from an eternal world to salvation. When these signs appear in you, you will know this is the end of your history in this world. No more dying, no more being restored to life, having gone through the gate of death, only to age, only to weapons, and to wait, and then to restore again and continue the journey in death. When these things begin to happen in you, You are the end of history. You are redeemed. But everyone will be redeemed. I don't care what he has done in this world. You may think of a monster like a Hitler, who actually murdered millions of innocent people and erupted the whole world. Or a monster like a skeleton. He still is God in that corner. And in this practice of this world, otherwise, so we all forget who we are. We look at ourselves projected and seek others. And we find them as enemies to our little wants, our little desires. And then we go to serve as these characters did. But they are redeemable. Not one can remain unredeemed. For indeed, God loses himself. God is the creative power of the universe. And that God is your own wonderful human imagination. That is God. There is no other. But then you have a notion why he is in this state. And he moves through events after events in the secular world. He hears the story, and the men who are about to self appoint the church do not know him, and they teach across of the text. And he tells them, I am worthful, not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. This second birth will take place in you, is born in that manner. It is born in the body. But you will actually place voluntarily, no one placed you in the tomb, no one took you home, you did it by yourself. You were the God who made the decision. And you are all collectively agreed on this venture for the extension of our service. And the end of death is your own, which is simply the human skull. And in that skull, we lay down. And then we began to be collectively the great queen of life. We are the gods who came down. And we are the gods who will one day inhabit the power of salvation within us. Now, when will it happen? We are told in Scripture, no one knows. No one, only the Father. Well, the Father is no sense, but you don't know that yet. Because when it begins to happen, you will discover you are the Father. You are the Father. And the whole thing begins to erupt within you. But only the death of your own being knows to what extent he has done in between. And when he reaches the end of the dream in the world of Caesar, then he awakes, and you are he. So no one knows, and no one cares, from the signs in the secular world, that this is it. It has nothing to do with going to the moon tonight. It has nothing to do with any new discovery in the world of Caesar. It's something entirely different. We are departing from this world and death by reason of the events that are not within us. And then they begin to erupt in his hearts. And it only takes 3.5 years from the first eruption of his resurrection. You find yourself in the movie. Now you tell the scripture, we shall all be changed in a moment. Not a few of us, all, in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet shall sound, and we shall be from the dead. But that's told in beautiful imagery. The word is suddenly a trumpet. The word trumpet means, by definition, reverberation. And may I tell you, if you think that you have a vibration in your body, you might have had one moment an electrical collapse. You must have, and so on. And you might have an experience of an intense vibration that you survived. But wait until this happens. When this happens, you have never in eternity felt such a reverberation. Your whole being reverberates and you think, you can't possibly entertain any other thought, and that this is it. This must be a massive damage. This is what they mean when one actually dies of a massive damage. But you don't die. Instead of dying, for the first time, you begin to live, or you begin to awake. And when you awake, you awaken your skull. To discover that your skull is a tomb, it's a sepulchre in which you were buried.
a new angel that sent them voluntarily, no manager to it. I laid them myself. I got the power to let it come to you, and the power to lift it up again. This is your story. You volunteered for the experiment, and you actually deliberately entered death's door, which is your own scar. And you don't know that you're there. You think you're on the other side. You wash your body, and you look into the mirror, and the other man is reflected, and you do everything for another man. You go up to get a job, try to fill up the mirror. You may have something to offer, and you struggle in this world of a counter world, and yet you are clean. You are in your own skull. You are the immortal God in your own skull, creating this dream of life. And then you decide that you have finished the dream. You play all the gods, or you play everything in the world. You play the decent person, and the one who is not considered the decent person. You play the whole world, and you play the loving mothers of Korea. You play the wonderful folk, or the business, the holy man. And you play the unholy man. You play the thief and the judge who's having judgment of the thief. You play every part in the world. And no one is able to escape playing all the parts. And when you play all the parts, and there is no other part to play, no one knows what is that playing part to play. You may be a good businessman playing it you up. You may be a doctor. You may be a thief. No one can tell you. What is the last part you want to play? No one knows the order in which you play them. But you will play all the parts, and there are so many parts. There are 12 new characters, and many, many, I would say, multiplications of these 12. Scripture reduces them to 144,000, but it starts with 12, only 12 sons. And then you multiply it by 12, then multiply it by 12. And basically, there are 144,000 modifications of the 12 major characters. But you play them. And if you haven't played them, you wouldn't play them. Because you will never make them from the dream of life until you play them. But no one is going to keep you in this world beyond that last character. And when you reach it, suddenly, you know who Jesus is. And he never was another. So if anyone ever tries to tell you, look, here is Jesus Christ, don't believe him. Or here he is. They can perform wonders, do all kinds of things, but don't believe anyone who points outside of you and says that is Jesus Christ. For Christ in you is the hope of God. Because you are the Christ, and he is the only wonderful human imagination. So don't go to any sign in the world. This is a marvelous thing we have learned today. Looking forward to the landing of the moon. I think it's true. Well, I'm concerned, I'm sure we are medical. And I don't know if you went to the TV on Sunday to watch that boy descend, or the two of them descend. I don't know if you went to the TV, I don't know. But I'm not in my election. And that's my prayer to watch it. Not only because I'm not in my election, and my father is not sure of Americans, but I'm not in the human religion. That's medical. But that's not eschatology. Has nothing to do with the coming to the end of this world. You and I are redeemed from this world of death by a series of events. And these events are recorded as events in the life of Jesus Christ. But it is in the individual that these majestic, dramatic events in the life of Jesus happen. They happen in us, but individually. You are too wonderful to have it happen collectively. You are in the dream, and no one can take your place in the eternal temple. And that temple is not something you practice. It is a function. It is a band, a real man, a living man, made up of humanity. Believe it or not, it is a man, and that man is in for the cause. And so it is presence, and it's a man. And it's not able to do anything but love in the presence of this man. And that man is the risen Lord. And we are called out of this world, one by one, to be incorporated into that body. But then we are a living star of dead spirits. We are returned to the world of death. And in us, we are life-giving spirits. With our loss of identity, we are part forever of that eternal living body. There is one Spirit, there is one Lord, there is one God and Father of all. It's a mystery, and the world teaches it as secular history, and it's not secular history. So when you get this meaning, you're highly under circumstances. Speaking of this, looks like the end, and you hope you'll be here when Jesus comes. They don't know who Jesus is. And so when some lady called me the other night and told me that I was most cruel to mention this person's name, who was highly emphasized, I mentioned his name. I thought of the words of Lincoln. And Lincoln said, to sin by silence when the spiritual gift makes the presence of the soul. And so he is speaking because he's highly emphasized, and millions are listening to him, and think what he has to say must be true. But he doesn't know the first thing about the ministry of Jesus. So he spends $15 million a year in publicizing himself and his work. So what? Peter was very loving too. And so was Peter. And there were leaders who believed in them. And there were his followers who believed in him. And one of the times he trained the impulse to tell you he doesn't know Jesus Christ and his mystery. Jesus Christ is an active believer. Just like praying. We have no record in this world. Search as we have searched, we have found no evidence of the historicity of the man in the name of Jesus. And that is the coolest story ever told. It happens in man. And our evangelists are all unknown. These names are anonymous. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. There is no record as to who Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John is. But there is no reason on this premise. When the time had fully come, that which was planned before the world was, began to erupt in men. And by men, I mean generic male and female. It began to erupt. And then they knew the mystery of salvation, the mystery of redemption. So I'm telling you what I know from experience. And if you should forget it, read the Gospels. And everything said in Jesus, you will experience in a first-person singular, present tense experience. And that is eschatology. That is the end of the journey in this world. You are told the scripture, you will enter a world that is strange to you, and you will be infinite for 400 years. At the end, you will come out with great possessions, far beyond what you had when you entered. So that's for all that I am ready. That's a false word. It is not altogether conclusive, or what is immediately evident with. So I tell you that sermon. But what does it mean? These are words stated in scripture as being uttered by the Lord to one called Abraham, the father of the multitude. So he goes into a land that is darkness, a strange land, and he's a stranger in the land, and he's in strange there. For 400 years. For 400 years. You must first understand that in the Hebrew tongue, every letter has a numerical value, as well as a symbolic value. Well, 400 is the numerical value of the last letter of the Hebrew alphabet, the letter Tov. There are 22 letters, and then there are 5 letters. But we keep 5 of the original 22, but basically there are 22. The 22nd letter has a numerical value of 400, and the symbolic value of that letter is a cross. And the only cross on which the Lord was ever crucified is this. The symbol of God, that is the cross. And this is a strange word to God. In a sense, it's a word of death, and God is the God of living. But here was the challenge. What if he came? If he had died, up to God. Actually, come in and take the form of death, which is man, and to go through the gate called death and experience death, and so you restore to life, and to continue and die again, and die again. And then finally, by his predetermined plan to rise from it all, and lift beyond what he was, come to that greater power, greater creative power, greater wisdom, greater everything that he had come to that. So this is the blessing. And the only Christ is that Christ, not a single little being that was born of a woman who didn't know a man. Then he became me. It is you that is Christ, and there is no other Christ. That is the great topic of Scripture. So when you find him, you will find yourself. And it will be the Son of God who reveals you as God of God. Your friend will know you. You will know him to be your son, and he will know that you are his father. And when you see me, and you go to the Scripture, and find that you are the Son of God, that is the personification of all the generations of men, and all the creatures of men. And when that one who stands before you represents all the generations and all the creatures of men, and you will go in hope, because you went through all the generations and all the creatures of men. And then, as a result of that, he stands before you, and he calls you Father, and you know you are his father. He is the voice of your God. And so when you know you are God, you are God's father. But no one can hear and convince you that you are God. You have to explain it. So I'm telling you those signs of the God. And you will have to, because you can't possibly know them. They're there. And we want to let them go forward and teach their false doctrines about the coming of Jesus. And all point to some sign of the heavens saying, this is the time for you to come. No one comes to the home, only the Father. And first of all, call no man unto the Father, because you have but one Father, and he is in heaven, and the kingdom of heaven is within you. Yes, there it is. Call no man unto the Father. You have but one Father, and he is in heaven, and the kingdom of heaven is within you, and you have yours. Yet all these people, these false teachers, insist on you calling them Father. How do they believe it? This must be called Father. And yet they said they are servants. Servants. And they are Father. Well, it hasn't come to me. But you see, I can speak for them because I can speak with authority. Because my authority is based upon experience. I can speak with the mystery of Christ. And so I am not fearful, I am not faithful. So when someone challenges my word and says, well, go on and challenge it. You're only listening to a false doctrine when you point to something Jesus as a being of flesh. He is born not of the flesh. It's an entirely different birth, it's a supernatural birth. You will be turned to heaven and only be accomplished by birth from above, as told us in Scripture. Except you be born from above, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. It's impossible to be turned when you become the present God. And so you learn not of the present God here from the time that you enter to the time that you go on. You become the man through the gate called death, you are dead. No one dies. At the very moment that you are dead, you are restored to life in a golden church like the other one, only God. Not even, but 10 years of age. Nothing missing. No truth missing, no fear missing, no eyes missing. Perfectly restored. Young and wholesome, healthy, pure with pleasure. And you do not express yourself in the sexual world as you did. You marry her, just as you marry her, and you get all of it. And you will pray and you doubt to find yourself restored to the soul. Young and wholesome, just like the other one, only young and beautiful. And you go on again. To all the struggles of any other ones, until the time of the age. And when the time of the age arrives, these eternal souls unfold in you. So, there's a specialist about this. Sacred history has already reached this climax. And it's true. It's not being changed, deserving change, but not sacred history. That's all done. And you will one day experience this sacred history. And you will know exactly who you are, you are God, the Father. Now, I will not take that one word out of it because I have the other one. If you read the book on that kind of book, he said, no one told it to me. Never heard of him, but it came through revelation in Jesus Christ. That's what he said. He was the very one who made the finished book of the entire concept. But it didn't happen in him. And then he understood it was not the external worship of the Lord. The rituals and all the things that the church of the world do had nothing to do with that. For your flesh, there's no filing against the kingdom. Just wait for that moment in time. So he carries a special authority upon the grace that has come to you and the revelation of Jesus Christ. For this is the hope that God will give us wisdom to accept the presence of this long gone life of time. So it seems a long life, yes, it is a long life. Gone life of time. I am saved for like 400 years. By 400 years, just as long as I wear the cross. But I'm confident that at the end of the 400, in the end of the end of the cross, I will come up with enormous possessions. Far more greater than what I possess when I finish it and come into it into the world again. And everybody is in the kingdom, not one can put up. When you meet her, and so the process is in the room, and all the questions.
I have a great call
of that time. I have a call
of
many. So I do not say that you can.
One cannot be
called and then you find again. I have a second. Yeah, what's that? I have a second one to say. I have a I'm doing it. For I'm sorry, and I take off voluntarily between 3 and 4 months a year because I find that I need this or less, and I need it for a very long time to my meetings. And yet, in my interval period of between 3 and 4 months a year, I have a week off. So I'm on a month occasion, on 2 months occasion, a couple of different places. So he's ready. I'm ready. I'm going to be in my own life, take off any time, and I am simply self-supporting in my job. I can do this, a very quiet and modest life, and yet I have a vision of what is doing this. I want to know how it is done. I want to see it happen. Given the courage, everything is for the amusement piece, and yet something. There was a pleasure or pleasure to say. It was nothing. A full common of the service. I can see my loved ones. I can see all the goodness that I have. I can see my family and his assistant. I can see the steps. They all look at me. Nobody did. I need a backup. I can see the future. And I can tell them, being my imagination, see all these things are always taking place. So I can turn in my imagination to this. And all the weekly, so beautifully. And they also said, no respect, not meaning God, for they call me by the title of the Lord. Yes, you see, it's because people say, no, Lord, Lord, so and so. But to them, in my words, their master, their Lord. Not in the sense of God, just in the other place of God. And they all meet me beautifully in this region. And I can see that fabulous way that I possess. And as a teacher, I didn't grow all my life. I said, because it's done to myself. And when I was very young, I was afraid because I did. And I am all deliberately walking out of that place and not be judged. I would not have a confidence in it and left it all behind. And yet, all the things and money that I bought, and I bought all of the debts. My home was beautiful in my life. Everything easily was amusing me. And my servants were beautifully trained. They're not just servants. They were the monks. My secretary, in the function of my servant, they were trained in their own style. Yet they were my servants. And I had a full complement of servants in my home and a full in my garden. I wrote them never to return. So I was very happy in this world of Caesar, and I made happy as well. And I came back in this time, I came here in a world of poverty. A father was born and raised 10 children. There were 12 of them died at birth. And so we were only in orbit of 13 because my grandmother lived with us. And he had little. And so I came to the family park. I needed it. And that is the last thing I could do with it. I am afraid of God. Before the God of this world to be turned to my witness. now return, like the prodigal son. The son has had an intense on my life to speak by a beast of the venture. Now all the belongs to him on my the first son that he knows. Maybe he has the next, though he was going to talk about it. There will be an emphasis on the way of the son. The son of the Lord is here. And to the next, a renewed pandemic in a world of death. But if he did, and he survived, and could get there, he would be an enemy on the right of the stream, a body, and those who did not know, do not fear that one. He is a new on the right of the creative. So I have this is difficult and see it so clearly in my mind. And yet again, this world, I will never tell you no more, modest, for me, my wife goes along with it to make your excessive demands on my purse, that I don't have any money to her. So if I never see anything else from her, that is everything, so I can't even run away. But I need more money now. We haven't got it too long. Can you go wrong? Get no text, or can you want to move on too long? So if I really can't learn that we have $2 in your face, but I want to get back home. But you can't do it. Are there any questions? Yes, sir.
Can we play a big role
in the monastery? No. The question is, can we play many roles in the monastery? I'd like to. Well, I certainly play many roles. The same identity, like the same actor playing in Hamlet, but playing Richard, playing something else, the same actor. Well, I was a dancer for 11 years, but I don't have time to work 4 days to pay me. But the last one was to work $20 a week. And then in the quiet, I said, well, I really did nothing. Business is slow. So, business is slow. I said, well, I'm going to do it for my next week when rent is due. There's not my power. So, well, continue to work, and he's doing a lot. I can see he doesn't understand the facts of life. When you're 20, you're full of courage to do all kinds of things. I was then 17. So he gave me a letter to his friend of the Macy's and said he doesn't understand the American rules. So give him a job again. So I was very, I think, 22 at JC Penney. And then 40, and then gave me 20. And he started to work at 20. And I said, if I did not work for any one of them, I'm going to stick this out just as long as I can, and I'm going to do it. This is how I find the place. They are going to fire me, and they will fire me. So I worked there for a year and 6 months, and then I had enough. Good boy, I said, let's move away. If no one will even excuse me, I'm quitting. And then from then on, I work for myself. So I become part of the thinking of these ex-convicts. They refused to work for another. They had it all within themselves and they wanted freedom and independence. All the qualities that they and big business leaders need and have. So you get the same kinds of answers. I ran out of the hill, Macy's, and bus boys putting change in the beam with it. And I saw all the little tricks of the trade. I saw how they operated because. As a bus boy, you see things. And some days you really want business, you wanted a she wanted a living body. And that was 10 cents more than the rest of the time. And so, unfortunately, I didn't have living white honey on display. I still kept the being filled. I didn't have it. So the same who took the order came back and said, the lady of Cyrus, you can't have any honey but living white honey. And you didn't do your job to keep the being filled. And so get one quickly. With the lily white honey and the lily white honey was the same honey, brought unmarked by the colonels. And the girls rolled in the lily white, charged 10 cents more, and rolled in the red star, and charged 10 cents less. So it took off the red star, and rolled into the white lily white, and she was satisfied, because she paid 10 cents more for it. And that's how business operates. For some reason, they did not buy a decent coffee because they did not have in themselves the image. Nothing of taste. Their taste buds are nothing. So they go into a store, they must read the price tag. So Thank you.